Hi. Now, before you watch this video, I have to sincerely apologize for my recent 2-month-long hiatus from doing movie reviews, and the reason is it's because I initially wanted to get this done for my wanted to get this done in time for my 2-year anniversary on YouTube way back in August, but thing is, I kind of left it just a little bit too late, really, to do that. So, yeah. But since it's now been over 4 months since the late great Christopher Lee left us, and that we're now in the middle of the Halloween season, this is a classic case of better now than never, really, if that makes any sense. So really, all that's left for me to say is, hope the wait has been worth it. Happy Halloween, everybody. And please enjoy the video while you still can. Six here, and in order to not only celebrate my second anniversary on YouTube, which of course happened as far back as the 7th of August 2015, but also to pay tribute to the iconic screen legend that was Sir Christopher Lee, who, as we all know, sadly left us over 4 months ago now, on the 7th of June 2015, aged 93, I thought I could do an extra special triple bill of reviews of 3 movies and 3 performances, which, to be perfectly honest, weren't exactly my personal introduction to the man and his obviously ridiculously fantastic body of work, but nonetheless they were pretty much the ones that truly catapulted him into the film stratosphere for the first time, and truly defined his career as not just an icon of horror, but also one of the most legendary silver screen actors this country, and even the entire world, has ever known. And of course I'm talking about the trilogy of films that, other than their 1955 adaptation of the BBC TV serial The Quatermass Experiment, basically put Hammer Films on the global map as the horror movie studio that we all know and love to this very day for the first time, and also began the Hammer Horror film tradition with a resounding bang. And they are their classic take on The Mummy from 1959, The Curse of Frankenstein from 1957, and their 1958 adaptation of Dracula, otherwise known as Horror of Dracula, all three of which were directed by Hammer Horror veteran Terence Fisher, were written by Jimmy Sangster, and starred the likes of Peter Cushing and Christopher Lee himself, who were both pretty much the Bela Lugosi and Boris Karloff of their generation in terms of classic horror, as well as Yvonne Furneaux, Raymond Huntley, Felix Aylmer, George Pastell, Michael Ripper, Hazel Court, Melvyn Hayes, Robert Urquhart, Valerie Gaunt, Michael Gough, Carol Marsh, Melissa Stribling, Olga Dickie, Janina, Faye, and John Van Eyssen. And I'm going to start off by reviewing Hammer's classic 1959 version of The Mummy, which is a loose remake of the 1932 Universal version with Boris Karloff, with some elements of the plot as well as most of the characters taken from The Mummy's Hand and The Mummy's Tomb, with the climax also being borrowed directly from The Mummy's Ghost, all of which were later entries in the original Universal Mummy franchise. And it also became the first Hammer film to be made after Universal, who were known as Universal International at the time, reached an official agreement with Hammer after the commercial and critical blockbuster success of both The Curse of Frankenstein and Dracula, allowing the studio to not only specifically use the name Karis in this film, but also to go ahead with producing remakes of most of their classic monster movies, such as The Wolfman, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, and The Phantom of the Opera. Now, the story of this version of The Mummy starts off in 1895 during an expedition in Egypt, where a team of British archaeologists that consists of this guy named John Banning, played by Peter Cushing, his father Stephen, played by Felix Aylmer, and his uncle Joseph Wemple, played by Raymond Huntley, managed to uncover the untouched tomb of an Egyptian high priestess named Princess Ananka, but in the process of doing so, they inadvertently bring to life her mummified lover Karis, portrayed by Christopher Lee, who was buried alongside the princess to eternally guard her tomb against any strangers who dared to desecrate it, because otherwise, he who robs the graves of Egypt dies. Whilst in the tomb alone, a mysterious encounter causes Stephen to be mentally paralysed and be sectioned off to a nursing home. 3 years later, an Egyptian disciple named Mohammed Bey, played by George Pastell, somehow transports Carus to England and unleashes him to exact brutal revenge against those who managed to desecrate the princess's tomb. After his father and uncle are both killed in mysterious circumstances, it is up to John to unravel the mystery of the curse, defeat Carus, protect his wife Isabel, played by Yvonne Furneaux, who bears a striking physical resemblance to the princess, and save the day. So, what are my thoughts on The Mummy 1959? While it may not be as good as Curse of Frankenstein and Dracula, and is thus marginally the weakest of the three, in my opinion, I still think that it is a great movie, and that it is one of the best mummy movies that has ever been made. And this is really coming from someone who only grew up with watching the 1999 version with Brendan Fraser and Rachel Weisz. When it comes to the story, especially if you are familiar with the franchise, it is basically pretty much the same story that's been told to death so many times before, but I thought the way Hammer executed it felt highly imaginative, fresh, original, and a little bit different to what you would normally expect in a mummy movie. The screenplay was very cleverly written by Jimmy Sangster. Terence Fisher's direction is, as always, brilliant, and I love the fact that he used a similar storytelling technique to what Steven Spielberg would later use in Jaws, in terms of, you know, being more subtle with both the horror and the suspense, and not actually showing us the mummy until well into the movie. The pacing is fantastic. The score by Franz Reisenstein, who replaced James Bernard, is great. The Eastman colour cinematography used by veteran Jack Asher is very vivid and does an absolutely brilliant job of imbuing a sense of dread and atmosphere throughout that is sorely lacking in most horror movies nowadays, that blatantly rely too heavily on cheap jump scares and gratuitous shock value for no other reason whatsoever than to be just quick cash grabs. The violence is much more subtle and isn't quite as gory or graphic as you would normally expect to see in a Hammer horror film from around this time. For example, in the flashback sequence where you don't actually see Carus's tongue being cut off before he gets mummified, but it's rather implied. The Victorian era set design by Bernard Robinson is great. The makeup effects on the mummy itself are fantastic for the 1950s, and they still hold up very, very well to this day. The acting is top notch here. Yvonne Furneaux does make for some appealing eye candy, but her character isn't given an awful lot to do, despite the fact that she does get to play a very important role in the story. George Pastell does a brilliant job of playing a vaguely similar character to one that he would later go on to portray opposite Patrick Troughton in the Patrick Troughton's Doctor in the classic Doctor Who story, Tomb of the Cybermen, that could have so easily become a generic and cartoon villain in lesser hands. Peter Cushing's character in this film isn't quite as heroic as his Victor Frankenstein or Van Helsing, but as usual, he does an excellent job of portraying this ordinary, likeable guy who is caught up in extraordinary circumstances beyond his comprehension. But Christopher Lee is the one that walks away with the acting honours as Karis the Mummy in this movie. Apart from having a few lines of dialogue in the flashback sequence, he gets the chance to do some of his best acting through the use of his lumbering physicality and even his eyes underneath all the bandages and heavy makeup. I love the fact that we actually get to see him breaking down doors and smashing his way through French windows, despite the fact that Christopher Lee ended up physically injuring himself several times whilst filming the movie, even nearly dislocating his shoulder at one point. Lee was not only physically imposing and terrifying as the mummy, but he also managed to make you feel truly sorry for this character and really care for him, especially in the scene where he attempts to kill John in his study, but Isabel bursts into the room and stops him by screaming out, "No!" The mummy then looks straight up at her, and you get to see this longing and tortured look in his eyes. It almost reminded me of Boris Karloff's performance as the monster from the original Frankenstein movie. And I think it was probably the real inspiration for John Carpenter to devise the character of Michael Myers for Halloween, for the Halloween franchise, in the sense that both characters are mute and unstoppable killing machines. Other than the creepy moment where we see the mummy for the first time as he rises up from the swamp, one of the best scenes in the film is a brilliantly acted scene where Peter Cushing and George Pastell have this polite, gentlemanly, philosophical debate, which gradually builds and builds up to a verbal confrontation between these two characters over differing beliefs, differing religions, and differing ideologies. It was dramatic, it was intense, and it very much reminded me of the confrontation scene between Bela Lugosi and Edward Van Sloan in the original 1931 Universal Dracula film. The only flaw that I have with this film is with some of the pacing issues during the extended flashback sequence that takes place in ancient Egypt within the middle of the film. This sequence in itself serves not only to explain to us how Princess Ananka came to be buried in the first place, but it also serves as, in a way, Karis's origin story, allowing you to sympathise with him and understand what his motivations are for trying to resurrect her before he undergoes the ultimate punishment by not just having his tongue cut off, but also by being completely wrapped up in bandages and being condemned to live out an eternally painful existence as the mummy. It is a fantastic sequence, but the problem is that it brings the pace to a little bit of an abrupt halt in my opinion. It felt a bit unnecessary and out of place for the filmmakers to show us every single specific detail about how Egyptian burials work, and it could have done with a little bit of trimming on the cutting room floor. If you are into mummy movies, if you are a really curious fan of Hammer horror, or if you are, in general, a Peter Cushing or Christopher Lee fan, I would seriously recommend that you give this version of The Mummy a really good watch. In conclusion, The Mummy 1959 was a solid way to cap off the initial run of great Hammer horror movies. It is one of the best mummy movies ever made, period. And my rating for it is going to be an awesome-tacular 8 out of 10. And now on to reviewing 1957's The Curse of Frankenstein, which is much more of a retelling of the classic Frankenstein novel by Mary Shelley than a remake of the classic 1931 Universal version with Boris Karloff. It was the first Hammer film and the first Frankenstein film to be made in colour. It was made on a budget of £65,000, and it spawned a series of sequels known as the Hammer Frankenstein series, almost all of which featured Peter Cushing reprising his role as Baron Victor Frankenstein, albeit with a different monster for each film. This film also became influential for not only kickstarting the Hammer horror film tradition, but also for essentially revitalizing the gothic horror genre as a whole after it suffered a decline during the late 40s and was pretty much dead in the water by the early 50s, which at that point saw a rise in popularity of science fiction B-movies featuring creatures from outer space and radioactive monsters such as 20 Million Miles to Earth, The Blob, and The Thing from Another World. Also, a brief fun fact for Doctor Who fans is that second Doctor actor Patrick Troughton originally had a cameo in this film as a mortuary attendant, but his scenes ended up getting cut from the finished film. Milton Subotsky gave Hammer the initial idea to remake Frankenstein before going on several years later to co-found Amicus Films, which would become the main rival studio against Hammer during the late 60s and early 70s. And at one point, the project was originally conceived to be shot in black and white and feature Boris Karloff as Baron Victor Frankenstein. But since Karloff was considered too old at the time to play the part, those ideas were quickly scrapped in favour of casting Peter Cushing in the role, who at that time was very well known for his many leading television roles, such as Winston Smith in the BBC's 1954 adaptation of George Orwell's 1984, and Mr. Darcy in their 1952 adaptation of Jane Austen's Pride and Prejudice, hiring Jack Asher to shoot the picture in Eastman colour for the first time, and a production that felt obligated to do something original with the basic outline and idea of the source material, as well as try to drastically differentiate itself from the Universal film as much as they possibly could, due to the fear that Hammer had that they were going to be threatened with legal action by Universal if they dared to duplicate any element from their version. And they weren't even allowed to use the iconic makeup that Jack Pierce created for the monster because of the fact that it was copyrighted by Universal. So it fell to makeup artist Phil Leakey to create a completely different and fresh look for their monster. Also, Christopher Lee was not the first choice for the role of the monster. Initially, the producers considered casting Carry On regular Bernard Breslau, largely based on his size. But when his agent asked for too much money, they decided to cast Lee right on the spot. And as a result of this, Lee would not only go on to have his turn in the limelight the following year with his role as Count Dracula, but he also sparked a long-lasting friendship with his co-star Peter Cushing, which would last until the latter's death from cancer in 1994. Now, when this film was first released, critics at the time didn't take very kindly to it and pretty much criticised it for its groundbreaking use of vivid red blood, sex, and extreme graphic violence, which was deemed highly controversial, and it was generally considered very inappropriate for a horror film around that time to show this kind of stuff on screen. However, it proved so popular with the public that it became a massive success at the box office, and it also became a major influence on the later works of today's filmmakers, such as Martin Scorsese, Tim Burton, Peter Jackson, and Guillermo del Toro. Now, the story of The Curse of Frankenstein starts in 1860 Switzerland, where Baron Victor von Frankenstein Yvonne, played by Peter Cushing, is in prison on death row for a series of grisly murders when he summons a local priest to try and protest his innocence by telling him the story of his formative years. And from there, most of the movie is a continuous flashback using a similar framing device to the one that Orson Welles used in Citizen Kane, except in this instance it is used for telling the story from Victor's point of view. Basically, Victor tells the story of how he inherited the family estate at a young age after his mother has just died, how he eventually got engaged to his cousin Elizabeth, played by Hazel Court, despite having a secret love affair with his maid Justine, played by Valerie Gaunt, and crucially, how he hired a private tutor who later became his best friend and work collaborator named Paul Kremp, played by Robert Urquhart, who taught him everything there was to know about medical science. After Paul and Victor successfully managed to reanimate the body of a dead puppy, Paul wanted to use this discovery for medical purposes. However, Victor saw this as an opportunity to take his experimenting to the next level, and thus became dangerously obsessed with the idea of playing God and creating the ultimate perfect human specimen. Paul was horrified and sickened by this, and instantly turned against Victor by saying that he didn't want any further involvement in what his friend was striving to do and was very passionate about doing, and that he only wanted to stay in the house to protect Elizabeth, whom he developed a secret crush on. Victor then decided that he was going to go ahead with the experiment on his own and stole different human body parts, including hands belonging to a recently diseased master sculptor from a charnel house, as well as eyeballs from a local morgue. He also cut off the head of a hanged highwayman in order to use his body and dissolved it in a vat of acid. He even successfully arranged for the murder of one of his old professors so that he can use his superior brain. In a desperate attempt to stop his former friend's descent into madness, Paul tried to wrest the brain from Victor, but ended up accidentally damaging it whilst doing so. Despite this incident, Victor eventually succeeded in bringing his creation to life, only for it to go tragically wrong when he realised that this creature doesn't follow a particular command and in fact had become psychotic due to the brain damage, and that its sole motivation was to mindlessly kill other people without it realising what it was actually doing. So, what are my thoughts on The Curse of Frankenstein? I thought this was just a brilliant retelling of the classic Frankenstein story, And in my opinion, this is one of my favourite Frankenstein movies of all time. Right up there with the 1931 version. Its sequel, The Bride of Frankenstein, from 1935. The 1994 version with Kenneth Branagh and Robert De Niro, which I already reviewed on the channel, by the way, if you want to check it out. And the 1974 Mel Brooks film, Young Frankenstein, with Gene Wilder. Not only do I admire the fact that Hammer had the balls to break new ground and be more explicit with their films in terms of showing, you know, heaving bosoms, violence and extreme gore, which, by the way, would nowadays be considered to be a bit tame and cheesy, but was an extremely big deal back in the day, in a way that no other horror film beforehand, like even the Universal films, had ever done before, like in the awesome moment when Paul shoots the monster in the head and you see the blood bleeding profusely out of him. And also a close-up shot of an actual eyeball that Victor looks at through a huge magnifying glass, which was originally censored out for the US release of the film. Not only do I admire them for taking the subject matter of the source material seriously, but not in a goofy, over-the-top or hokey sort of way. But also what I found interesting is that out of all the Frankenstein films, this one feels darker, more personal, more compelling, and more character-driven, which I love, because whilst the Universal films mostly focused on the monster, the Hammer films turned to the opposite side of the spectrum, so to speak, and actually focus on the Baron himself. Speaking of Baron Victor Frankenstein, Peter Cushing was simply amazing as this character, and not only does he give one of the most definitive Victor Frankenstein performances of all time, even managing to surpass Colin Clive, but he also manages to give one of his most iconic scream performances of all time in this film. And he almost plays the character like a younger version of his Grand Moff Tarkin from the original Star Wars. Whilst Colin Clive's interpretation of Frankenstein was more of the archetypal mad scientist who you kind of felt sorry for in a way due to him having a horribly misguided sense of ambition, Cushing's interpretation of the character is fantastically darker. And what I mean by saying he is fantastically darker is that Frankenstein is a 100% irredeemable, insane, and morally despicable sleazebag who throughout the film becomes increasingly self-absorbed, increasingly addicted towards creating this monster, and furthermore corrupted by his work to a point where he would go to any dangerous lengths, even murder, to further conduct his experiments, which, by the way, leads up to one of the best and most disturbing scenes in the film when he actively murders the professor from the top of the staircase. I love the way the scene was shot. It was a miracle that the stuntman who did that scene managed to pull it off without breaking his neck. And I also loved the subtle symbolism in this scene of the figures in the Rembrandt painting almost staring directly at Frankenstein, as if in horror, as if in abject horror at the sin he has just committed right in front of them. Christopher Lee obviously doesn't quite live up to the legendary performance that Boris Karloff gave as the monster. He doesn't get an awful lot of screen time until the last half hour into the film, and he isn't really given much of a chance here to flex his acting muscles a bit more. But nevertheless, his monster makes for a physically imposing, intimidating, and terrifying presence on screen, especially in the iconic moment when he wakes up for the first time and takes off the bandages as the camera zooms into a close-up shot of him revealing the truly messed up and scary looking face underneath, with the pale green skin, the bad haircut, and the blindness in one eye, to name a few, before he attempts to strangle Frankenstein. The makeup effects on him, courtesy of Phil Leakey, are quite brilliantly gruesome, and they make the monster look like he's been genuinely stitched up together from the corpses of different people. I also love that Lee's portrayal of the monster is a mixture between a confused, brain-dead child and a lumbering zombie, which oddly makes me wonder if George A. Romero took inspiration from this for his creation of the zombies in Night of the Living Dead. Hazel Court and Valerie Gaunt are good in their roles, and they are good eye candy, but I don't think they had really nothing that much. But they had really nothing that much to do other than look pretty for the camera and be the obligatory hammer girls, so to speak. The other supporting performance I really liked in this film was from Robert Urquhart as Paul Kremp. He did such a fantastic job as the likeable foil to Frankenstein, and I think it's a huge shame that this guy didn't go on to make any more notable works after this. Whilst the scenes with him constantly trying to, you know, dissuade Frankenstein from what he is doing do feel a little bit repetitive at times, I genuinely cared for Paul's character in this film, because throughout the film he is given no other choice than to abandon this man who has been his pupil and best friend for years because of the realization that his friend has pretty much sold his soul to the devil. Almost pretty similar to how in Star Wars Revenge of the Sith, Obi-Wan loses Anakin to the dark side when he becomes Darth Vader. Everything else about this film is nothing short of brilliant. From the fantastic as always screenplay by Jimmy Sangster, to Terence Fisher's fantastic as always direction, to the fantastic pacing, to the wonderfully atmospheric Eastman colour cinematography by Jack Asher, to the great score by James Bernard, and even to the amazing set design, which would become a staple for most of Hammer's subsequent films. I also love how the ending leaves everything that happens in the film a little bit ambiguous, and you end up questioning whether any of this actually happened for real, or whether Frankenstein actually did commit these murders without even realizing it, and is making this whole story up in a desperate attempt to get out of his execution. If you are into the classic Frankenstein story, if you are a Peter Cushing or Christopher Lee fan, if you are a curious fan of Hammer horror, or if you are just a true horror fan in general, The Curse of Frankenstein is a must-see, and I cannot recommend it very highly enough. In conclusion, The Curse of Frankenstein is a fantastic film that mostly succeeded in what it set out to do, which was to cement Hammer's reputation worldwide as the British House of Horror. It is one of the best Frankenstein movies ever made, period. It features one of the greatest Peter Cushing performances of all time, and of course my overall rating for this movie is going to be a 9 out of 10. I'm Dracula, and I welcome you to my house. And now, with that slightly dodgy Christopher Lee impression out of the way, let's finally go on to reviewing what is considered by many horror fans to be one of the most definitive adaptations of the classic vampire horror story of the same name by Bram Stoker, other than the 1931 Universal version with Bela Lugosi. And that is, of course, Hammer's 1958 adaptation of Dracula, which, rather than being a remake of the Universal film, which in itself was actually an adaptation of the stage play by Hamilton Dean and John L. Balderston, is much more of a very, very loose and streamlined adaptation of the novel. It was the first Dracula film and the first ever vampire film to be made in colour. It was made on a budget of £81,000. It spawned a series of 8 sequels in what will be known as the Hammer Dracula series, 4 of which featured Peter Cushing reprising his most iconic role as Dr. Abraham Van Helsing, which I'm going to get into later in the review, and 6 of which featured Christopher Lee reprising his signature role as the titular granddaddy of all vampires. It was purposely retitled Horror of Dracula when it was released in the US in order to avoid confusion with the 1931 version, which was getting a re-release at that time. And it was made in the wake of the commercial success of Hammer's previous film, which was of course 1957's The Curse of Frankenstein. Also, due to strict censorship by the BBFC at the time, some footage from a couple of scenes had to be trimmed out of the film due to some of the extremely graphic and sexual nature of the content, which they considered to be too gruesome to show to a mainstream audience. And the film was even given an X certificate at the time it came out. When the film was digitally restored and re-released here in the UK by the BFI in 2007, it was given a 12A rating. Some of the footage that was cut was thought to have been lost forever until 2011, when an extended Japanese print of the film was discovered in Tokyo, and some of the lost footage within that print was eventually reinstated into the film for the 2012 HD transfer, which was then released on Blu-ray the following year, along with the 2007 BFI restoration. And that is just a little bit of history about the film itself. Now, the story of this version of Dracula takes place during May of 1885, as Jonathan Harker, played by John Van Eyssen, travels all the way to Castle Dracula in Klausenburg on the pretense that he is going to take up the position of being a personal librarian for Count Dracula, as portrayed by Christopher Lee. However, the twist is that Harker is actually an undercover vampire hunter who is completely aware of who and what Dracula really is, and has come to put an end to the Count's reign of terror by killing him and anyone else who are infected by his evil with a stake through the heart. However, Harker eventually fails in his mission when he decides to instead stake one of Dracula's undead servant girls, and is consequently turned into one of the undead by Dracula himself, forcing his friend and his colleague, Dr. Van Helsing, as portrayed by Peter Cushing, to stake his old friend through the heart and take his place in fulfilling their mission to destroy Dracula before he claims the lives of both Harker's fiancée, Lucy Homewood, portrayed by Carol Marsh, and his sister-in-law, Mina, as portrayed by Melissa Stribling, with the aid of Harker's brother-in-law, Arthur Homewood, as portrayed by Michael Gough, thus culminating in an ultimate showdown of good versus evil between Van Helsing and Dracula. So, what are my thoughts on Dracula 1958, or rather, Horror of Dracula? Well, out of the three Hammer horror films I have seen so far, this is by far the best one I've seen. In fact, I would even go as far as to say that this is one of the best film adaptations of Dracula I've ever seen, along with the 1931 Universal version and the 1992 Francis Ford Coppola version, in my opinion. Nosferatu from 1922 I haven't seen, but I will get round to reviewing that version in a future video. Anyway, I also have to say this film is pretty much what the 2006 TV movie with Mark Warren and David Suchet should have been had the BBC had the common sense, had, you know, more of the common sense to stay true to the essence of the novel. Dracula 1958 is just such a fantastic film. It works on so many levels as a horror film. It's one of those films that I personally couldn't find any faults with. And it's quite clear that Hammer were on fire and were at the top of their game at this point in time. There is also a bit more red blood featured in this film than there was in Curse of Frankenstein, mainly due to the fact that this is obviously a vampire film. And you also have to bear in mind that this was the first time that audiences got to actually see vampires attacking their victims by biting them on the neck. For instance, at the beginning, when, you know, Jonathan Harker gets attacked by one of Dracula's brides, played by Valerie Gaunt, who, believe it or not, is the same actress who played Justine the Maid in Curse of Frankenstein. They also got to see actual blood dripping out of a vampire's fangs, like in the iconic shot that surely must have given people nightmares, where you see Dracula with this really savage and animalistic look on his face, like the blood sort of dripping out of his fangs, and especially the red bloodshot eyes, which, by the way, were actually contact lenses that Christopher Lee hated wearing because they pretty much blinded him in between takes. In fact, it's even more hilarious to find out that when he was filming the scene where Dracula runs towards his bride before throwing her across the room of the castle, he even ran too far past the camera on the first take because he literally couldn't see where he was going. There are also a couple of stakings shown on screen, with only one being implied off-screen. And even during the opening title sequence, you get to see blood splattered over Dracula's tomb. which helps to set up the atmosphere and the tone of the rest of the film brilliantly. I mean, as I said before in my review for Curse of Frankenstein, all of this stuff I have just described to you guys is nowadays considered to be quite tame and cheesy, if that makes any sense. But at the time, it was considered extremely controversial, and critics and censors didn't really take kindly to this at all. The story to this film is not quite the most faithful adaptation of the book, with only a few plot deviations and character changes here and there. You know, speaking of which, Renfield doesn't feature in this adaptation at all, which is a shame, you know, especially for, you know, Dracula purists. But then again, that doesn't, it didn't really matter when I watched the film, because it is, because it was so good that I completely forgot that he wasn't in the movie, which I guess is a good thing. Yeah, is a good thing, I suppose. But it is rather a much more simplified and condensed series of key events from the novel. And I also love how it just gets straight to the point without, you know, without getting, you know, too bogged down in any, you know, plot complexities or too much exposition. The screenplay by Jimmy Sangster is fantastic. Terence Fisher was on top form here, with some of the best filmmaking he has ever done for Hammer. The cinematography by Jack Asher is incredible. The score by James Bernard is nothing short of flawless, especially the opening theme, which seems to literally scream out the title Horror of Dracula with each note, you know, da, 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 da. The set design looks amazing, as it usually is with most of Hammer's films. Most of the practical effects that they used for the blood in this film looked amazing. The film moves at such a fantastically brisk pace, because a lot of stuff happens in this film within a space of, you know, 82 minutes that doesn't feel, you know, rushed or drawn out. And I actually found myself glued to the screen while I was watching the film within the runtime whilst I was watching the film. The acting in this film is fantastic. The supporting cast, including John Van Eyssen as Jonathan Harker and Charles Lloyd Packer's Dr. Seward, as well as other supporting players such as Olga Dickie and Janina, Faye, all did such good jobs in their roles. Carol Marsh and Melissa Stribling both did great jobs as the two main women, Lucy and Mina. A lot of people say that Michael Gough kind of underacts in this movie, but I thought he did a great job. But I personally thought he did a great job as Arthur Holmwood. And his scenes with Peter Cushing were enjoyable to watch. But the real stars of this film are, of course, the two leads, Peter Cushing and Christopher Lee. First off, Peter Cushing does such a fantastic job as Van Helsing. Not only does he take the role seriously, not only does he imbue his performance with the sort of gentlemanly elegance and class that he usually brings to pretty much everything he does, even when he's playing, even in his bad guy roles such as Victor Frankenstein and Grand Moff Tarkin, but he also shows a much more caring, benign and paternal side, especially briefly during the little scene where he comforts the maid's daughter after her encounter with Lucy in her vampire form. There are also some subtle hints of his later performance as Sherlock Holmes in Hammer's 1959 adaptation of Hound of the Baskervilles, which I'll probably get round to reviewing in the near future. And you could also see in his eyes that he is a badass and that he is absolutely determined to get rid of this force of evil that is Dracula. Now let's get on to Christopher Lee as Count Dracula. I mean, it's just very easy to see why this role has been considered to be, you know, one of his best known movie performances of all time. Because as iconic as Bela Lugosi's portrayal of this character is, Christopher Lee as Dracula in this movie was just fucking awesome. Even though he doesn't have an awful lot of dialogue to say in the movie, in fact he only says a maximum of just 13 lines to one character on screen, Jonathan Harker, you cannot deny that he has a huge physical presence throughout the film, which makes the scenes where he seduces Lucy and Mina all the more unpredictable and terrifying, because you cannot predict what he is going to do or where and when he is going to strike next. And you could clearly tell that he was having a whole lot of fun with this role, despite the fact that he would later go on to reprise this role 6 more times, and despite the fact that he desperately wanted to avoid falling into the same trap that Bela Lugosi fell into, which was of course being, you know, typecast in the role, because Bela Lugosi's portrayal of Dracula was so iconic and became so synonymous with the image of the traditional vampire that the poor guy ended up being pretty much known for nothing else for literally nothing else other than Dracula for the rest of his life. Heck, even when the Gozy died in 1956, he ended up being buried in his Dracula costume. But I'm kind of digressing a bit here. Also, a review of this version of Dracula, like this one, would not be complete without talking about the ending, which has to be one of the best in cinematic history, period. Not only does it feature one of the best climactic battles between Van Helsing and Dracula, but it also features one of the most iconic Dracula death scenes of all time, as Van Helsing leaps up across the table, rips off the curtains to reveal the morning sun, and uses two candlesticks for a cross, which, by the way, wasn't in the original script, but it was actually an idea that Peter Cushing himself came up with, causing Dracula to gradually disintegrate into dust, which of course is a knowing reference to Count Orlok's demise in Nosferatu. And it's very easy to see why it has influenced so many filmmakers over the years since then. Most notably Christopher Columbus, who took inspiration from this scene for the way Professor Quirrell dies in Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone. Now, if you are a Hammer Horror fan and haven't seen this version of Dracula yet, or if, like me, you're aspiring to become a bona fide filmmaker, I very, very, very highly recommend that you give this film a watch. And so, in conclusion, Dracula 1958, or aka Horror of Dracula, is an absolute Hammer Horror masterpiece. It is one of the best Dracula films ever made. It is one of the best horror films ever made, period. It features two of the most iconic performances of all time from its two leads, and overall, it abso-fucking-lutely deserves the highest possible rating I could give it, which of course is an awesome-tacular and perfect 10 out of 10. And I also want to say thank you so very much, Sir Christopher Lee, for all the amazing memories you have given us, and all the wonderful films you have made over a career spanning 7 decades. I may not have been able to meet you in person, but you will be deeply missed by every single actor, director, and crew member who had the utmost privilege to work with you, and also by the movie-going community as a whole. But you will never, ever be truly forgotten. And you, my old friend, are the true definition of a movie legend. Once again, thank you so very much. And rest in peace, Sir Christopher Lay. With that said, please feel free to leave a comment in the section below and let me know your individual thoughts on The Mummy 1959, The Curse of Frankenstein, and Dracula 1958, or Horror of Dracula as it is otherwise known. And also let me know in the comments, what is your personal favourite of the three films? Plus, feel free to subscribe to my channel. Don't forget to like my Facebook page if you haven't already. I also want to thank each and every one of you guys for subscribing to my channel for over the last couple of years, because without you guys, my channel wouldn't be where it is today. And for that, I'm eternally grateful to you guys. And until my next video, which is going to be a special review of the first Scream movie to pay tribute to another horror legend, who has so sadly passed, and that is the late legendary horror filmmaker Wes Craven. Do take care, everyone. And happy Halloween!